same vehicle every day, I know it's a pain in the butt, but who knows if you take a different vehicle the next day or a different trailer the next day, and you do a post trip, right, find nothing wrong, but then the next driver comes on and takes that trailer or tractor and they find something wrong that you didn't pick up, that's why you do them both. You do a pre-trip and a post trip. Alright? First thing I do when I come up, I'm looking at the DOT number, I'm running DOT number to make sure you got operating authority. Just got a good rating. So, I'm going to do the door. I'm going to come up to you. I'm going to get up inside the door. Talk to you face to face. If I ate garlic last night or ate a little worse than an onion sandwich, it's your fault. but I'm going to see if I can smell anything that's not supposed to be in there, like any contraband. Believe it or not, a lot of drivers will be smoking weed, and I can smell it in there. Even if it's not been smoked, I can smell the dry weed. All right, and that's why I get up into the cab when I'm talking to you. Okay, it's
well,
not for me.
You really actually run into that. That's ridiculous.
But put it this way, 3 out of 10 times.
Really?
Yeah. Okay, it's not because I want to get there and kiss you, but it's because I want to see what's in there. Okay?
No, I mean, how often do you actually run into people smoking weed out on the road like that? Okay,
not smoking it, but half prior to, okay, because the smell will linger inside the vehicle.
Yeah.
Okay, I've been smoking it, say, 2 days ago. That smell will still be in there.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay? That's the reason why I get up there and I want to make sure there's nothing other than maybe driver fatigue or something else, other than if you have some type of impairment, I just want to make sure it's not some contraband in there, okay, other than medication.
Yeah.
Okay? Another reason why I open the door is to make sure you have your seatbelt on. The seatbelt's hanging down here, okay? 9 times out of 10 you didn't wear it. They'll retract once you take it off.
You'll leave it on until you look in.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
Okay.
All right, till we get to you, leave it on.
Yeah.
All right. I'll get up there. Obviously, you got an e-log, so I see that you got an e-log. Sometimes we'll say it on the outside here.
Go in the door.
Okay. I'm going to ask you for your paperwork. I'll ask for your license, driver's license, registration, medical card, shipping papers if you got it. And I'm going to ask you for instructions for the e-log, city log. Like I said before in the presentation, that's what I'm going to ask you for. I'm going to draw in the cab. Another thing, radar detector. Same thing, a radar detector?
We don't need it.
Tractor's shut down. Yeah, they're shut down.
I'm just letting you know, if you do have a radar detector in there, it's a violation. Okay? Cannot have it. I'm just saying, because sometimes, believe it or not, I called a driver one time. I saw a cord coming from the cigarette lighter going back into a cooler just behind the seat. I picked it up and he said, "What's in there? Radar detector." Well, I haven't used it. But it's in the cooler, ice cooler. I'm picking it up, it's freaking hot. You haven't used it. It's still plugged in. So, it's a violation. I'm looking to position your cab. 9 times out of 10, if I see the fire extinguisher sitting there, I'm going to get that initial contact with you. Other than that, I'm going to go back, do my paperwork, and I'm going to come back to you again. I'm going to start in front of the vehicle. I'm going to have you turn all your lights on. Another thing, I didn't bring up New York State, HUD permit. You got to have the HUD permit, or at least a temporary in the cab. All right? That's a company problem, not yours, but they know they have the, that's a good spot for it. This is what it says. The regulations say you must be displayed on the front near the plate, as close to the plate as possible. Obviously here, you won't be able to see it. Right here, if I come down the road, I can see this right here. All right, if I can't see it, that's probable cause for me to stop you. All right, Canadian drivers, they got them on this side, up here. I can't see it.
I've seen them in the vent windows.
Gotta be right here, somewhere near the front. Like, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Your company does very well with it. Next thing I'm gonna do, I'm gonna ask you to turn all your lights on. I'm gonna check all your lighting. Okay, headlights, low beam, high beam. If you got high beams, if, believe it or not, it's required. High beams are required. If you look at the regulations, it says you must have all of them, all lights working. Now, the extra lights you may have on here, little marker lights alongside, they're not required. I'm not worried about those. Worry about the cab lights. The three in the center are called ID lights. The outside ones are called clearance lamps. All right? looking for your front turn signal, right turn signal, and your four ways in the front. Windshield wipers and washer. Make sure they're working, and then your horn. You only required one horn. I know you got two. You got a city horn, you got an air horn. Only one's required. I don't need to see both. Or hear both, I should say. I'll move along the side here. Steer axle tire. I'm going to check the tread depth. How much?
432.
Correct. I'm going to check your wheel lugs. Obviously, here I can see by this quick look that they're all tight. I'm going to check for cracks between the stud holes, the hand holds. Any cracks in between there? Render it out of service for the wheel. But that's very, very rare that I see cracks. And then usually they're on an old rim. Okay? You don't run split rims anymore, do you?
No.
Okay. All right, I'm going to check driver access here into the cab. Make sure it's safe. Work my way around. I hate these type of air fairings here because I can't get underneath it. I'll check between the tractor and trailer here. Spare tire if they got it. Fuel tank. Make sure it's secure to the frame. Make sure it's not leaking. If you got a reefer like this, usually has an auxiliary tank somewhere. Right back here. And make sure this doesn't have a leak in it. If you got a fuel leak anywhere, dripping, just a drip, it puts the vehicle out of service. Okay, so there'll be no leaks anywhere on fuel. I'll check your glad hand hoses. Like this one here, like I told you before in the classroom. See how it rubs down here on the deck?
Yeah.
See right here? It continues rubbing. You could limit it to an out of service condition sometime down the road. But right now, these look pretty good. So somehow you want to try to keep these off the deck if you can. This normal roll vibration will cause the chafing in the holes. These springs, supposed to be up here. Okay. What they do is prevent this from kinking. See that connection is right here? If it continues on like that, what's going to happen? It's going to cut into it. Correct? That's what these springs are for. So make sure they're up there. All right. This one here, it's got some new connection here. So that's not going to go anywhere. A lot of times you'll get leaks here in the glad hand connection, the donut there, or the grommet. That'll be bad, and you'll get a leak there. If you do detect a leak, we'll check your reservoir pressure. Make sure your compressor will be able to hold the pressure with a full brake application. Later on, these are air hoses going into the trailer. I can't see anything here because it's got the coils on them. But I can see, again, up here on top, as you can see, is a driver. I don't know, you do a pre-trip in the morning, it's dark, I know that. You gotta get a flashlight out, right? Just look down in here, make sure everything's fine in here. You look at your springs, okay? Anything you see right here, you look at your fifth wheel. Look at that in a second again. I'll go back to the tires here. How many in these tires?
Two.
230 seconds?
Two.
Okay. I'll look at these. Again, all the lugs. I'll take a look at them. Make sure there's no cracks in the wheels. Same thing with the next set here. I'll look at those, the trap depth, the wheels. Underneath. I'll look at your fifth wheel. I'll make sure the handle's pushed in. Maybe it was your company. Probably got some time. Left Canada go wine. Forgot to put the locking handle in. Came out. As soon as they came out of the parking lot, the trailer fell off. I don't know if it was your company or not.
We've had a couple of them happen out here in the yard. I know that.
You never checked the locking handle to make sure it was pushed in.
I always do a tug.
I'm going back a number of years.
About a week ago, I saw one in Pennsylvania across 219. I pulled out and got halfway across, all the way across the road.
You can tug. It may hold for that tug, but as you move and turn, she'll open up, unless it's locked. So
right.
Tug doesn't mean anything.
Another thing, I think what his problem was a high hitch. So just make sure that's flush. You're not on a high hitch. All right? You get a high hitch, you're never going to lock. This is being a Freightliner. I'll look at the spring hanger right here, make sure there's no cracks in here, in the frame here. I did one 3 weeks ago down in Campbell, on the trailer. Both sides cracked right up through here. You know, so What happens if you lose that? The spring hanger. Where's your drives going? You're going one way and they're going the other. I'll come back here. Again, on the newer trailers, I'll check for the inspection. This one's good till May of next year. You'll see this is where it's screwed up here because it says date of inspection, May of 2015.
That's that one up here, though.
Yeah. See, this one, something's wrong here.
Periodic inspection.
No, this one's not.
This is a new one. This one we just put on here. But whoever did this one punched the wrong ear. Right. It says date of inspection. It hasn't been inspected. It's not even 2015 yet.
That's from the manufacturer. That's what the brand
trailer is. Okay, on the newer trailer, you all know this retro reflective sheeting. They got me on here. Mud flaps, the newer tractors from 2001 up. On the mud flaps, the upper portion of the mud flaps, the retro reflective sheeting's got to be on there. I'll check your New York plates. Yes.
Just to clarify, what kind of clearance do you look for? It's a distance versus
for what?
Mud flaps.
Okay, there's a rule of thumb.
Yes.
Okay, there's a rule of thumb for mud flaps. And what it is, this height here between the ground to the bottom of the mud flap can be no more than 1/3 the distance from where the tire contacts the pavement to this mud flap. So if this distance is 24 inches, this could be no higher than 8 from the bottom of the ground.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. Just wanted to put that out there and clarify.
Okay. Landing gear, again, this one's fine. This is what I'm talking about. This continues going loose for a while.
Yeah.
Somebody had a problem with that bolt's going to start shearing. Okay, so if you bungee cord it, just wrap it through here and hold it in, you're fine.
Okay.
I think what he was also asking was if this is, if this is broken off and it's just kind of...
And it's just hanging out there like this while you're going down the road and you see this.
Again, as I said, there's no regulation on this here. Okay. What I'm saying, if it continues on, where this starts to shear off and this falls off and starts bouncing behind you, hit somebody in the windshield.
Bungee will still keep it pinned in.
Bungee will keep it there.
Regardless.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just your call.
Yeah.
Okay? As far as us to write it up, we're not going to write it up.
Okay.
All right? I'll work my bank again. Got auxiliary fuel tank for the reefer. I'll check for any drips there. Securement to the trailer. This is all new now, these aerodynamic boards. This is for fuel mileage.
Well, we can't go into California without them.
Okay.
To hide all the problems of DOT don't see it.
Are you the one with it? It's got the picture in there with the clean cab. Okay, I come back here. Same thing. Tires. I'm gonna look. Okay. What do we get back here?
Yeah, your lock and pin.
Tread depth.
Oh, 2/3.
Okay. Same thing here. And I'll check your drop cords that goes to the trailer. Make sure there's no improper repairs to a hose. What's the proper repair for a hose? Anybody know? You cannot put a piece of plastic pipe or tubing and hose clamp it together. That's improper.
You can't splice it.
It's improper splice.
Tape, right?
Yeah. Only correct way of doing it is with DOT connections. Okay? Or a brand new hose altogether. All right? Believe it or not, there's a lot out there that have those improper splices. Piece of pipe and hose clamps. I'll come back here. I find a lot of duct tape on the glad hand hoses, believe it or not. And if that's another thing. If I see electrical tape on glad hand hoses,
wires.
Well, I don't see wires that much, just tape. I'm going to untape it all.
Yeah, and see if it holds on.
Well, I'll see if there's a hole in there.
Yeah, okay.
This is a giveaway, but sometimes I'll tend to use it so it doesn't chafe if it's chafing.
You lose connection, too. That's
right.
Why they load it with duct tape.
Right, so it doesn't chafe around. Distance from the kingpin, start of the kingpin to the center of this axle, no more than 43 feet on a 53-foot trailer. Okay? This is fine.
Why isn't that marked on these trailers?
It doesn't have to be. That's a company. If they want to do it that way, they can mark it. They can measure it from the center of the kingpin, mark 43 feet back here. They wanted to put down 43 feet. Then that's when you know when the center of that axle is at. That's right there where that arrow is. Now you know you're 43 feet. You go beyond that, then you're in violation.
Measure back 53.
No. It's from the center of your kingpin. You gotta go from the center of your kingpin.
Yeah, but you gotta go from the center of the kingpin.
Right here. This rivet. This is the center of your kingpin. From this rivet to the center of the rearmost axle can be no more than 43 feet. Okay?
But if it's less, it's fine, all right?
If it's less, you're fine. Okay?
Okay, that's kind of what I was asking.
Yeah, you're less, fine. You can't be more. And like I said, if you look at the site, each adjustable axle trailer, usually they all have four pins.
This one does.
If you look at the distance between the holes, it's probably all 6 inches. So if you move it one pin, if you're more than 43 feet, you're probably within the regulations. But also look here, when you check it back here, make sure your pins are all engaged into the adjustable axle. If you have more than 25% disengaged, it's out of service. But 25% is just one pin, normally. So it's gonna be more than 25%. So you're either gonna have two on one side or one on each side. All right? And in my whole career, I've only found maybe four that been like that. Back here, I'm gonna check. Again, the lighting back here, your rear end device here. Yes.
Why do you try to see if it would work? If something would
help cool it, I don't even look at them. Okay. I only look at the ones required. The ones required, the ID lamps on top, the clearance lamps on each side, license plate lamp. Believe it or not, I write it up. If it's not working, it gets written up as a violation. It's got to be there. Taillights, rear protection. ABS now. ABS is something new. It comes into play now. It's ABS light. Anything 2001 and newer on trailers, when you turn the key on, this must come on and then go out. Okay? If it does not come on when you turn the key on, next thing I'm going to check is if it hit the brakes. Give me a brake application. If it comes on then, I know you got power going to it. The next thing I'll have you do is pull the power cable. That's what happens. It resets the system. Pull the power cable and it should come back on. If it doesn't come back on, then what they call it's an ABS power circuit. It's not functional when you turn the key in. But it works when you put the brake pedal on. But we know we got ABS back here. You just don't have a continuous circuit. All right?
What if the tractor doesn't have ABS?
Well, again, it's another thing too. We look at the tractor. You're the tractor.
Now, what it, an older tractor doesn't have ABS.
Right. Then this doesn't apply to this thing because you're not gonna have ABS coming back here.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
So what we'll look in the tractor, in the dash, you're gonna have like I said, the newer ones. You can talk from 99 up on the tractors. We'll have an ABS malfunction lamp in the dashboard. 2001 trailer and up, you'll have a trailer ABS malfunction lamp in the dashboard. Depending on the year of manufacturer and the tractor, I'm trying to say to you. All right. All 2001 and up have some type of malfunction lamp going to the tractor, depending on the year of the tractor. All right, and that's what we look at. Is it a ticketable offense? Yeah, but we don't write it. Or I don't write it, put it that way. All right, and just make sure they're working and they're working properly. All right. So that's, again, that's something I didn't bring up in the class, but that's part of your pre-trip. So if you can turn the key on in the start, you see the light come on, you know you got power going back here. Or if you hit the brake, check your brakes. If you're by yourself, you check your brake lights back here, you see it come on, you know you got something going back here at least when you hit the pedal. Alright? You always, when you turn the key on, well, whose truck is this? Anybody's? Volunteers?
Whoever. This one's out of service, right by the way.
Just somebody go, is the key on? Is there a key in the tractor or not?
Yeah, there should be. Yeah,
just turn the key on. You'll hear a click coming back here. Just to show you what I'm talking about. See it? Come on. Hear the click?
Yes.
The light came on. Okay, go ahead and turn it off.
Yeah.
See a flash and all. It should come back on. Go ahead and turn it back on. See it? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's the proper way it should work. Okay?
And that click is checking the system.
Yep. And this tells me when this comes on, it did its checks, it's working properly.
What if it stays on?
If it stays on, you got a problem. On the trailer. You got a problem with the ABS on the trailer.
Same way, if it don't come on, you have a problem, right?
Right. Well, if it doesn't come on the same way, it could be the light, it could be the sensor. Okay? But if it comes on and stays on, you know you got a problem somewhere in the trailer.
I've had them where they've stayed on and then 45 minutes down the road,
it went out.
It starts working properly again.
So you got a problem. Still got a problem. Yeah, like I said, it could be a big one. Just check it. Well, make sure it's secure. You got a roll vibration that's going
to
move it.
As far as the other side, same thing, guys. Same thing as on this side, you can do the same thing on this side. Okay? And then you go back in, no problems. You do your book, logbook, you're fine. I go one step further. Like I said, depending on the year of the tractor, I'm going to open the hood up. Check your pitman arm, your drag link. Your air hoses underneath. And then I find nothing wrong. I go back to my car. Get a piece of paper saying no violations.
$200.
No violations. Good deal. No, if you get no violations, that's what you want. That's what you're looking for, no violations.
We can pull out of
that's what I'm saying. It'd be cool to just make sure if you do detect something wrong on your pre-trip and tree,
are you
somewhere?
Not working this weekend?
Nope. I know if you got
you're working weekends. Huh?
Nope, make sure you got a DVIR somewhere. So just don't record violation on your e-log.
It is.
So I'm sure there's
a. Working 5 days a week though?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
8 hours a day or less?
Yep, 8 hours every day.
Well, so if I ask you, do you notice any violations this morning, you say yes, you did, and have I asked you to record them, you show me.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have other column tools.
That's what I want to know, because we can do that, because all these new call cabs are updated now. They get more, like you said, macros in there. They got more things to put in. Before it was just bare bones, hours of service, that's it. So, now I'll go back. Give your paperwork back along with you guys who are qualified, and you're on your way. And normally, for me to do a full inspection from start to finish doing paperwork, probably anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes. It's going to be tight up for you. Okay? No violations, you've done it. Down the road.
That's not a grand.
What's that?
Not a grand. Wrong. Not a level one.
No, that's level two. Level one is where I actually get under the cab. I'm going to check your brakes, adjustments, everything. It's a full-blown inspection. But right now, level one, depending on if you find anything. Level one takes you a minimum of 30. Because you got to get underneath it. Right. If you find something wrong, this takes long. I've hit them over an hour on inspection in level one. I find so much wrong. You know, it's not, like I said, it's not the inspecting of it, it's writing it up in the report. Well, that's the time part. Other than that, I mean, unless you haul hazmat, I'm looking to see if you got a seal, depending on what type of load you got. I mean, if you're hauling food products, all right? This probably does, it's refrigerated, it's a reefer. I'm not going to open it up. Well, because most of the times, if they're coming from Seneca Foods, which is a legit company, I'm not going to worry about it. Do I open every door? No, I don't. But if you got a hazmat on, you can be well aware that I am going to look at your hazmat. To make sure. I'm going to look at your qualifications for your calling hazmat. Make sure you got a hazmat endorsement. And make sure it hasn't expired in your license. One more report. Like I said, usually if it's reefer stuff, reefer runs, I'm not going to open it up, depending on what it is. But again, like I said, if you got a sealed load, just be aware that we can't open that sealed load. Unless it's a Department of Defense load or U.S. mail. If you're hauling U.S. mail, yes, we can stop you and put you out of service for hours. Yeah, speaking of that. And then it's on you to call the postal company or the postal service to get another driver down. Continue your run. Okay? Just let you know that. If you ever haul U.S. mail, I think you did one time, didn't you?
We do a little bit.
So I did put a couple drivers out one time for hours. I think I put one out for being suspended too.
Is that on my welfare check?
Yeah,
could have
been. Could have been. But, guys, that's it. I mean, it was a quickie.
Yeah.
But that's
basically all it takes for me to do it.
Find out how the hell they rearrange.
Again, I'll come back. I'll look at yours because the fire extinguisher. So see the fire extinguishers there. I said, dude, see if there's one in there.
Right. This guy said he wasn't working this evening. What was he doing on this day? Oh, he was up in Boston. They told you he was up here. Sure. You have a cell phone?
That's what I say. You get cell phones too.
Hey, I have a question for you. Load security.
Driving. When we were on Black in North Pennsylvania, if they secured the load or the helicopter and the rack with a little 2x4s on the floor, we have to put the load bars and the straps across the back of that load.
Is it going to prevent that load from shifting? Those 2x4s on the floor?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what
I'm. If it prevents that load from shifting, you're fine. Like paper rolls. Oh, here you go. Canadians are great. I'm going to hate the Canadians, but this is good. Paper rolls. They'll transport them. I get them at the Peace Bridge in Buffalo. I'm opening up. These freaking things are. I mean, these are 4,000 pound rolls. I'm looking, I don't see any no load bars, no load locks. I'm looking. Where's the mats? Well, they're under there. Other than that, yeah, they got to be seen. They got to be bigger than the roll. Called skid mats, which is a load secure, form of load secure. As long as I can see a load mats, you're fine. If I don't see them, you don't have them.
It seems like a lot of those paper rolls, the skinny little thing underneath, the only cover's not
here.
I
am close to this. What the skid mat? No, it's got to be seen.
It's got to be. It only covers like under half of it?
No, it's got to be the whole thing.
Yeah, well, they're not covering.
No, it's gotta be the bowl. It's gotta be over out. That bowl. Again, well, that's when your company goes back to the shipper and say, hey, unless you hold this trailer properly, we're not going to transport it. Because nine times when it comes down to the bottom line, you're driving, you have an accident because of a load shift, so they're going to fall.
What
do you look for on your tanks? In a box trailer or
what? Well, a container, you know, with a box on top of it. See what skids
are there. Talking about
intermodal.
What I look for? Nine times I don't get inside of them. They took because he came open doors out. Definitely. If it's a hazmat, yes, I'm going to look open it. Okay. There's really nothing to expect on them because they're sitting on top of an intermodal chassis and you got 4 points of securement on it. And usually in the front, it's got a pin going through the front to hold it from side to side. And on the rear, you got a little concave turnbuckle that turns to keep it down. That's it.
Do those need to be secured with zip ties?
The handles, locking handles, like I said, some means of securement to prevent them from opening up.
Some of them have like a little metal bar.
Some have metal bars. I've seen them with zip ties, and there's been a lot of discussion on that. If I've seen them with zip ties, as long as it's keeping it closed, I'm not going to worry about it.
We did it the other day. I'd say the driver got stopped. There was no zip ties holding it down. We used seals, but that's what he had. You know, the officer let him go.
It's fine.
So,
there's
got to be something in there.
Something to keep that handle from opening up. Just the handle itself. Because the actual rolls we should. Like in a brake hole. If it goes long enough, rubbing against something, what's going to happen? Well, secondly, it's going to chat to its cores. Okay, so when you get a bump, you know, all the problems we got right now in New York State, you get a hard bump, what's going to happen with that handle? It doesn't come up. And if it comes up, it's going to loosen that one piece of securement there. If you get one, it opens up. And now you get another bump, now it's going to come up. And I've seen it done. Because all the front does is just keep it to the front. Take it from side to side. Really, the security you got is the one in the rear.
Any other questions? Ask, and don't be afraid. You're not going to get a ticket for it, so.
I was in a situation once, John, where I was coming back across the Canadian border, and they had, first time I'd ever seen it, with a scale set right in the middle of the road.
Where? They
were,
Lewiston?
Lewiston, yes.
I don't know, that's a...
Well, what had happened was, when I came out of the booth, there was a trooper that told me what he wanted done. When I got down to the scale, that trooper wanted something else. I said, well, that's not what that trooper said to me up there. So he said, when I got here, this is what he wanted. And the trooper at the scale said, well, he goes, I don't care what he wanted. He goes, I'm here and this is what I want.
Hey, just to tell you. So I can't say they want to money thing for that.
No, but I mean, it where I was going with that is when you got somebody telling you one thing and then you get to the other end
and I understand.
And that guy is going, well, don't mess with me. Well, you're only passing.
I understand. I've seen it happen. Believe me. But just do what they want you to do. And if you got a problem afterwards, then you can do it.
Well, it seems kind of.
I do see a lot of letters now coming from Lewiston.
Yeah, we do.
Not the Peace Grace, but Lewiston.
We do pay. Yeah.
They were checking gross weights and they wanted to get my gift tax. And that was loaded. It was on it.
The box trailer? Oh, okay. Yeah, just checking gross weight. I can't say because I don't know. I'm there, so I'm not going to make judgments. But
as more than one of these
others, there's always more told us.
You get told one thing by one of you, and you get to the other.
I understand. Yep. Go ahead, ask a question, guys.
How's the time? When it comes to the intermodal, those door containers, if there's a problem with one of them, like lights or anything like that, I got stopped at 490 one time and the chassis was out of inspection, but didn't go on any of them, didn't go to Leonard's or us, went to Dole. What is considered, when are we considered at fault for?
Okay, on an intermodal container, if there's any violations found on the chassis itself, and it's not your chassis, you're going to get two inspection reports. Okay, one's going to be with your name on it, your full name. Okay, that's for your carrier, your company. The second one's going to be with just your last name on it. That's the one's going to go to the chassis owner. Okay, the other one's responsible. Your carrier's not responsible for any problems on the chassis.
Is that include carriers and
carriers? The chassis owner is responsible. Whether it be Interpol, Atlantic containers, whatever the case may be, you are rolling the chassis.
And then
it goes against them, not the carrier.
That includes tires, brakes, anything?
Yep. Anything on the chassis goes to the carrier, to the chassis owner. Does not affect the carrier really.
So if tires are on spec, does that still affect us? You know it's...
When you pick up that container, number one, because we're going to ask you, were you provided a safe location to do a pre-trip inspection? That's one thing. That's one question. The next thing is, did you do a pre-trip inspection?
I don't know.
If you said yes, like I said, just on a walk around, you see a bald tire, and you didn't record that violation, okay, it's on you and the carrier.
Okay.
But it's going to be, like I said, when you get those inspection reports, two of them, it's going to say right there, those questions that I just asked you are going to be in there. The box will either check yes or no. Okay? And that's going to be, and you said, well, I told them I did. But then the inspection board says no. So somewhere you either lied to me or you lied to your company.
Guys, and understand specifically on the door containers, we put a policy in place to hold the driver that pulled that container out of the port responsible for pulling out of the container. We want to know about those things so that we can connect with the guys coming out of the port. They've got to take their time to go through the inspection lane, look at the container, the chassis before coming out.
Yep. provide you a location to do the pretrip. The chassis owner, or the port, Port Elizabeth, Port North, wherever it may be, it comes from there. And then, again, did you actually perform the pretrip? If you didn't perform the pretrip, shame on you. There was something wrong when we stopped. And I do a lot of intermodals. I check a lot of intermodals. So the situation that's going on in the Mideast and stuff like that, I check a lot of intermodals. So, I just don't want to find it at all. I just don't want to be the person, and you want to be that person, that might have been listed low in there, but you didn't even know about it. All right. So I'm going to go home tonight. I'm working. Now I've got 3 months to do it, so. Anything else? Ask you guys, come on. Don't be afraid. Because you don't want me, you don't want to go out there. You look familiar too.
I'm John Seale.
Yeah. Like I said, I'll be out there every day. Don't be afraid. You don't want to ask in front of your full patriots here? Call Ryan. Ryan can get a hold of me or somebody else at Troop.
Could you send us an email where the DOT inspections are going to be for the day?
We want to make sure we get all right here at 332 of the tollables.
For you?
No, we don't disclose. All right. Unless we see you out there, we see a violation. But most of the time, it's going to be a control location. We stop you. Either a double slot or the rest areas. Yes, sir.
How fussy are you on the airlines coming from the truck to the trailer as far as rubbing? For instance, the.
Okay. Before, this is before this year. If it was chafing against something, had a chafe mark on it, we write it up as a violation. All right? Now we don't write it up unless it's out of service. Okay. What I mean by out of service is either leaking, cut, or the reinforcement plies are exposed.
Okay.
You know, we write it.
So the airlines can be touching each other. I mean, the opposite going.
Oh, through. Yeah. They can be touching. I'll tell you. I'm going to tell you the driver if I see it on the decks. Steel decks behind the tractors. If I see it rubbing, I'm going to just let you know. It says this way, it's going to put you in an out of service condition.
Right.
So it continues on. For me, it's right as a violation, though. Not unless it's out of service. I write it up. It does happen all the time. I mean, normally during the normal course of transportation on the road, it won't happen. Things do break, they get rotted, they get brittle. Even the hose clamps, all the brake chambers, they get brittle from heat and everything. They break, and they're going to start rubbing. Unless you show something that puts it out of service, it's going to be written on.
Hold your bungee cord and not hold your curtain.
No, not cord not loose current. They're tie downs.
When you took take something and put it behind your cab, whether it's that spare tire or something on the deck, like a bag of salt or something, and you run that punchy cord across, it's not loose current.
No, it's not. Just keep that. Okay, spare tire in the trailer. How many punchy cords is keep it in the tire rack? How many don't put anything on it? You know, talking about the spare tire rack in the trailer?
We have.
Okay. Well, let's see if you get one in the trailer and it's sitting in a little tire rack at an angle, right? Does anybody put anything in there? On the tire
there? Sure, there's a chain.
One of them had a chain.
An answer, chain, yeah. Or a tie down. Not a bungee cord. If there's nothing there, it's unsecure.
All right, question.
Yeah.
So you have the chain secured to it and you still don't trust it. Can you put a bungee cord in it? You've got the chain there. And it's secure.
Yep, as long as you got something else there.
And you can put a bungee cord, because I've seen them.
But I've heard of a good chain.
Bounce.
Okay, a good chain. Nothing but twisted link links in it, bent links, gouged links. Okay, a good chain. Okay. Because what happens to a bungee cord when it gets hot? I mean, other than that, what happens other than that? It gets brittle, right?
Yeah.
And bing, the rubber band.
Okay, all right.
As long as the chain is good. Okay.
What I was saying, you use the chain that they provided, it's good.
Yep.
Okay. And it's secure. But say the ass end is bouncing. I've seen them.
You do it.
I put it like a bungee cord, just to hold.
Always got one chain. It's all that chains in the loop prevent it from coming out.
Okay.
Not, we don't care about bouncing up and down. We just want it to come out.
Well, yeah, like I said, I've seen them. I've used the chain, and I've also thrown a bungee in.
That's fine. Well, this is one mainly all source of the securement is there.
Okay.
That's fine. Same, like what I was saying about the tire behind the cab, the bungee cord is not going to cut it. Okay? That's not securement. All right. There is no working load on a bungee cord.
How about a trailer handle?
About gear. Landing gear?
Yeah, landing gear.
Yeah.
What if there is nothing to secure it? Or you throw it off?
The crank.
You know how the crank can be sometimes just hanging like straight out?
Yeah, but there's stuff in there that's going to come off.
No.
Right? It's got like a universal joint on top, right? It's got a universal joint. Well, it's got to turn the crank, but it's secured to...
It's got a nut and bolt on it.
Yeah, I can still put a bungee cord in that.
It can be hanging down loose.
There's nothing in the regulations that talk specifically about a landing gear handle crank.
Okay.
So a bungee cord.
Okay.
But I'm saying, over a period of time.
Then write it down so we fix it.
Right.
Yeah.
Because going down the road.
But we won't be shut down.
Well, what I'm saying is, like anything else, you go down the road, regular transportation, you get all that vibration, now that bolt may get broken.
Yeah. Anything you can
fly. Then if you lose that handle and it goes down flying through somebody's windshield. Like I said, if it's loose, put a bunch for it. That's out of the regulations. Anything else, guys? Yes?
No. It just did a DOT inspection.
Good for you.
I got a marker laid out. Hoping.
Yeah.
Shop is all tied up. I'm going to go in the city and I'm going to unload, but I know I'm coming right back. I'll get up there on 490 and pull into one of your service areas, and all of a sudden, oh crap, I forgot to write it down. And you get, I mentioned it to you, or you can do your inspection, and I forgot to write it down. You're going to hold it against me as you will, I tell you I'm pulling right back when I get unloaded.
Where's the toilet paper at?
Yeah.
No. I mean, you get hung. Does he get inspected? Do you inspect it?
Yeah.
Did you find it?
I don't know. It's just something I pulled out of the air.
Oh.
Definitely is an example. I just forgot to write it down, but like you know, I forgot to write it down.
Still a violation.
Yeah.
Okay. This is still a violation. Does that affect you? Because at CSA, I really don't get into when they first came out with this thing 3 years ago, 4 years ago. It's mainly put the faults on the companies to make sure that it's on the spot, the driver's on the spot.
Yeah, it wouldn't be me, so every time I walk to the shop, you'll see the range and walk through the wood.
Well, basically, like I said, we're not out there, but maybe it's out there. The reason for these inspections is to get the unsafe, the ball by driver's off the road, and the unsafe to come out.
The thing I'm basically saying about it is, even though you did it, you forgot to write it down.
You got EBIR?
You got to say that all the time, but you just have to write it down.
And you didn't do it?
I didn't do it.
I had sex last night too, but I didn't know about their
interview. I saw some new technology this past week where they're putting cameras on the trucks. In particular, the one that I saw was they had a side camera and a rear back camera. And the people that were talking about this technology said, when we turn on the left wing, so they had a left side camera this way. Blind spot. Great stuff. That's my mind. I'm sitting there thinking, distracted driving, you're not supposed to have this vehicle while you're going down the road. What's
again, until they get to the regulations for that. But they just had the CBSA convention in Buffalo. So maybe that was one thing, the new technology might have been part of that coming up. I don't know. I probably won't be around when it comes up. But as far as technology, how many have cell phones? How many use them when they're driving? Okay, unfortunately for commercial vehicles, you cannot have any cell phone, texting, talking whatsoever. Okay, even if you're stopped and not moving. Okay, if you're at a traffic light and you got that in your phone, ear, you cannot have it. Passenger cars, you can. New law just came out, I mean, it was just an amendment to the current law. If you're in a passenger car, as long as you're not moving, you can be talking on the phone. As long as you play, they go ahead and traffic, like, once you start moving again, it goes down the way. As far as commercial vehicles, not happening.
Is it
Bluetooth? You can't have traffic light, you have a folder. Can you use the Bluetooth? Is hands-free, yes. Oh, you can hands-free, you can hands-free.
I read, so it just said no electronic devices.
Hands-free.
That's
what they say, and don't do it.
That's a company policy that no cell phone use.
They don't want you using it, don't use it. Okay? Because if you get involved in an accident, you may not be in violation with us or the state law. It would be a violation of your company policy, and they could lead to dismissal.
But I do pull over.
Unless you get involved in an accident.
I do pull over, though.
Before
you can. You can pull over and stop and talk on the phone.
All right. You just said.
Just don't do it for a don't do it for a roll check location. Don't be on 390 and stop a quarter mile down the road before the inspection site and say, oh, I said stop the answer my phone. Now you got to get a ticket for stopping and updating. Okay? Like I said, you see all these signs out there. It says tech stop 5 miles. Get to the if there's an inspection up there, get to that location first. You're going to be waiting. You might be one of the ones getting late right now. Then you can stop at the end there and do your conversation. Right? I mean, I'm just talking about normal course of driving, going down the road. If you're at a traffic light, okay, so pull over to the side of the road, stop, talk, and do that. Just like I said, just don't go before it's
fun.
Put inside a little check.
Yeah, the sign
same
right next to you says emergency stop and only that phone call is not a red
thing. Right. Right, you never know until you make the phone call.
Just don't go, because like I said, depending on who's stopping you, if you made a piece of paper in this jury that you find there's a lot of points in the records like this. And as far as the CDL, it's a serious violation. Okay. So, speeding is a serious violation for the CDL.
Does that get understand if you're in your personal vehicle?
If you're in a personal vehicle, the CDL doesn't affect it. Okay. As far as
but you gotta be in a commercial vehicle.
Right. But alcohol, again, doesn't affect you if you're a person, you get arrested for DWI in your own personal vehicle. It's gonna affect you as far as law is concerned, as far as the CDL is concerned. It doesn't affect your CDL, but you will lose your CDL. You're going to lose it anyway. You won't get 6 months. Who's the conviction? Who drinks?
Everybody. I like my coffee.
Who lets your wife drive? Not drinking, but I'd rather drink.
It's safe for drinking.
That's probably the wrong way to drink.
Any more guys? Go ahead. Don't be afraid. Come on.
I was wondering about using the map on your cell phone. Would that be
pull over. That's a device. Unless you got a Garmin sitting on your dash, or you got your phone sitting in a holder on the dash.
Okay.
Okay.
If the phone is on a holder.
If it's in a holder, you're fine.
Yeah. That's
hand free.
I know, Mark.
Yes, sir.
You pick up wine on a hand for it tomorrow?
Yeah.
I brought the guy to give me a bottle of wine. He bought the wine, so I can't carry it in the truck.
Let your wife drive.
Okay,
no, don't have it in your vehicle. Any possession is, again, it's a serious violation.
Can you put it in the chair with the other wine?
Yeah.
It's on the
if they give it to you,
officially, you go.
Again, it could be in a box or something in the trailer. All right, I'm not gonna get a nickel and dime you. As long as it's not in the cab where you have access to it. All right.
Oh, CBs, they still radio to talk on?
What?
CB radios.
Don't you talk on one?
You got one?
Yeah, I got one. You got one?
Yes, I do. I hear you talking all the time. I'm a trucker.
You can talk on them, right?
Yeah.
That's not hands-free. That's not two hands around the world.
It's not a phone.
I know.
What if it is a phone?
What I'm saying. Texting, talking on the phone.
But it's a CB.
That's a CB.
But I need a CB.
There's no regulation on CBs right now.
The CB can be a problem.
Well, we can start. Well, we can start new legislation for it if you want.
I know where
you're
coming
at.
Don't give you CBs.
Yeah. If they're under control and they're using them and they got a prescription for it, current prescription is, and it's no longer on your medical certificate that you need it. All right.
They have to be in a labeled container as well, right?
Original container. Original. Not in an envelope.
Right. In your pocket.
Right.
See, you're on something prescriptions. I've heard some of the guys jump in on a truck that's been sitting there for a day because a regular truck is available. And they ask, what should I do? Someone else's prescription is sitting in the truck. As long as it's sealed on in someone's name, you still should have it in that vehicle, right?
Correct.
If
you're dispatched. Let them take care of it.
Guys, don't make prescription drugs.
No medication.
That's prescription drugs. Talk about Advil?
No, I'm talking prescription drugs. I got the containers, but you also got them in my weekly
go box. If you're going to carry a prescription, if you're over the road, make sure you have the container.
I've got the container, but I also got a book bag for the days.
No, for home. That's for home.
Okay. Got to be in the original box.
So I'm saying is you're a professional now, okay? You're over the road. The pill box is only good if you're on your own vehicle or you're at home. If you're over the road, original prescription container.
Okay.
Okay? Even if you got to carry 20 bottles. I don't know which medication you're on. But if you got 20 of them, you grab 20 of them in the original container. All right? If something is going to affect, and if it says on there, it may affect your driving ability. Don't drive.
No, they don't say that.
Or it may not.
Yeah, totally fine. Just again, you know, like I said, I've been doing this for so long, and I can tell if somebody's fatigued. Like I'm having to come up to you on your face, and your hair is all, I haven't combed your hair yet, and your eyes are like, I got to be like this. I said, you're not alert. And that'd be my call. I know you all look, looks like a woman. How do I know you, it says you took 10 hours off. How do I know you only took 5 hours off? You know, I need a logbook. I can't prove that by looking at you. That you just, you're not alert. Believe me, sometimes if I drink, my eyes are like this anyway. I gotta clean the booze out of my eyes in the morning. But I can tell if somebody's fatigued. That's probably what happened down in Delaware.
Bus driver?
Yeah. Well, you remember the first one we had on our Victor?
Yeah.
Yeah. People out here? I did that one. I've heard.
What about that one down on 390?
I did that one too.
You're talking about
that was a blown tire though.
Was it a blown tire?
It's a blown tire. A blown tire. Lost
it. By Mount Morris?
Yeah. By Kalachi.
No, by Mount Morris. That's yeah. I'm going back 3 or 4 years ago where the bus ended up here in this yard.
That was water for the bus. Yeah.
Well, that was I did that one too. That's the throughway. That's where I got the tractor trailer rear ended the bus.
No, the bus rear ended the tractor trailer. We're on 390.
No. I don't know that one. I've done three. I've done the one here in Victor. I've done the one in the throughway where the tractor trailer ran into the back of the bus. I've done the one in 390 where it went into the woods into the creek.
This was a different one.
Wasn't there one just recently on the throughway where a tractor trailer ran into a bus like 2 weeks ago?
Not an in our area, I don't think.
I thought I saw that on the thruway.
It could have been. I didn't hear anything about it. I just know the ones
it's
I've
like
done.
Like weeds board.
Oh, yeah. I remember that one, yeah. I didn't get involved in that one, so I don't know anything about that. I think there's the three I've done were one we put the bus and the tractor we both started on up here. Both fields burned right out.
Yeah, I remember seeing it in the yard for quite some time.
After that was a good one. Yes, sir.
What about that?
You allergic?
Yeah.
You can have that.
I wish. Well, a lot of times they put them in the garage, the box.
That's prescribed. Because my granddaughter's got it.
Prescription is going to be on the box.
That's fine.
Like two or four.
If you've been, yes. If you get stung by bees like that,
right.
Yeah.
But if you do not have the prescription written on the container,
as long as you have a prescription somewhere, okay. You wouldn't have an empty pen if you needed it anyway. Everybody got it for some reason. You know, my granddaughter, I don't know why, she grows with everything. Tree nuts, and then. Anything else, guys? Well, I mean, here for you. The old guys. The veterans. How many? Any questions? You want to go back to the old ways, don't you?
Sometimes.
You falsify your laws and you're like, look at them, right?
I learned to cheat logging before I went to the truck.
No paper trail anywhere. I'll start looking at them. Just go take this off and pick up the next one tomorrow and come back. We need the money.
But we can stop in the street, put out a tenderizer on another hour. Now, if you hate to stop and sweep because you screw up your hours, and then you can sweep all you want, and it didn't count against you.
Unfortunately, there's been so many accidents since that time, and they figured it's all related to driver fatigue.
Yeah, I just don't understand how they can tell me when I'm going to be tired and when I'm not.
You look tired now.
You can book your service. And then go home.
Anything else?
Anything else here?
Do you want me to show them the swap run on the vehicle, please?
No cigarette break anymore?
That's not doing that driving.
I'm not walking around the truck out there giving a little idea.
Do you got any other questions? Ryan or anybody, you guys probably don't know here. If we can't give you the answer, we'll research and we'll get the right answer. All right?
We got any free passes?
I know it was quick. Okay?
Oops, sorry.
Like I said, I talk very fast, but I've been doing this so many years. And you may not be able to understand me, but again, I've been walking through all here this morning, the physical that I do. And we'll give some insight. What do you expect out there on the roadside? All right, thank you.
Are you going to tell the last person to give a citation he's the rookie one?
Yeah. I'm going to go to court. Just to go to court.
You're not going to Florida, are you?
No. California.
Worse.
Good luck, guys. Stay friends.
Thank you.
Well, I thought that was very good. Interesting. So, we're going to do more of these as we go along. We're going to change the meeting schedule next quarter a little bit. We're going to do one like on a Thursday night. We're going to do maybe one in the beginning of the week or maybe a Sunday night. Or we're going to try to move around a little bit. But we're going to have the last one on Saturday, and I will have another speaker in here. I think every quarter we need to bring somebody in to shine a little light than me telling you all the time, okay? You know, because a lot of times what I got to tell you is always a little bit on the negative side.
because it's all the stuff I deal with every day. Somebody else coming in and tell you a report, the insurance company, we're self-insured, but they do have some kind of system that they have an auditor that will come in. They're kind of tough to listen to, you know. I mean, I got to listen to them, and I tell you why, it's not a matter of thing. But you know, if I can get one that's interesting, which is real hard to find, we'll work on that. But again, you know, I had Penske here a couple years ago. We do a lot of work with Penske, and we do a lot of work with Ryder. Okay, and I know a lot of the Ryder and safety and Penske safety guys. And this, the Penske guy did a nice job last time I was here a couple years ago. So I think I'm going to shoot for him towards the end of the quarter, unless I can find somebody different. I thought about bringing a federal guy in, but they get kind of, they won't read off anywhere off sideline of that book, you know. And if you go home, read the book yourself, okay. You got to find somebody that's willing to go on above it a little bit. Work within that little gray line area a little bit. If you get any ideas, or there's somebody that you heard in the past that you think you want to hear again, if you let me know that, I'll do some research and try to find them.
Father and son team.
Pardon?
The father and son team, bring them back.
Who's that?
The father and son of Rosetta, which you already scored the job.
The father of all the...
I don't know.
You remember that?
He's from North Baldwin there.
Oh, Bob McFarland.
That's it.
Bob McFarland, yeah. He's got him and his two sons that work. One son's out of Ohio, the other one is out of the Poughkeepsie area. And of course, Bob's out of Saratoga area. They've been around a long time. Bob's done a lot of meetings. I've been involved with Bob for many years in meetings. So, and that's another thing we could look at too. Bringing Bob back. Come back down. I know in the KJ days and stuff, they had him. When I was in the Clean Right Day years ago, we had Bob come in all the time. He used to do air brakes, he used to do safety, all different things. So we will keep looking at different avenues to make it something different. And a lot of you here today, I really appreciate you coming out. Enjoy the day. It's going to be a beautiful day. So thank you guys for coming.
Don't forget to take pictures.